Good evening, everybody. We'll call to order the February 14th, 2017 meeting of the Vancouver Public Schools Board of Directors. It's our chance to feel the love for public education on Valentine's Day. I'd like to start out by pointing out that all directors are present, with the exception of Director Dale Rice, who has an excused absence today. And we're going to start out with special recognition of students from Skyview High School. And we'll call up Principal Jim Gray, Skyview Principal, and Kathy Gillespie from the Board of Directors.
Good evening, Dr. Webb, members of the board, cabinet, and community guests. Skyview High School has implemented intentional and positive core values over the past 2 years. These core values are trust, integrity, and a commitment to excellence. Throughout the month of December, Skyview High School students representing girls basketball, boys basketball, and Key Club gave of their own time to help others in need in the local area. They represent the best of our core values in action as they brave winter conditions throughout the holiday season to raise a whopping $12,610.21, earning Skyview first place in the entire nation for high schools.
Woo-hoo!
Please help me congratulate these programs. Unfortunately, our girls basketball team is playing a must-win game up in Tacoma for a shot at the state tournament and are not able to be here. However, representing boys basketball is our head coach, Matt Gruler. Representing Key Club is our president, Kellyanne Tran, and our advisor, Elise Azor.
So on behalf of the board, congratulations to the students who would have been here if they weren't so involved, who stepped up and pitched in to support their fellow citizens through the holiday bell ringing program. This is actually the second year that Skyview's Key Club has won the national competition. So congratulations on your back-to-back titles. In the past 2 years, the Storm Key Club has raised nearly $20,000. That's a big, big number, so thank you. It's encouraging to see all of you engaged in working to make Vancouver a better place, and I hope that each of you will continue to look for ways to contribute and inspire others to join you. So congratulations, and on behalf of the board, thank you so much.
Thank you, that's a hard act to follow. But fortunately, we are calling with additional student representation, and we have our high school students who are here to present their board reports for this month. And we will start with Vanessa Higgins from iTech Repertoire.
Good afternoon, Dr. Wen, members of the board, and community guests. My name is Janessa Higgs, and I'm here representing Vancouver iTech Preparatory. Today, I'll be talking to you about what it means to be an outstanding student at iTech, an example of an outstanding student that is a part of iTech's community. To start, these are some skills that our teachers push us to gain through the content that they teach us in order to help us in the future. We are taught future-ready skills, which include being able to problem solve and collaborate with those around us. We are also taught how to manage our time wisely, be assertive, engage our creativity, and be critical thinkers. These skills allow us to be confident learners and take control of the learning process that we go through. I think those skills and control of our learning process, coupled with the attributes like hardworking, involvement, motivation, leadership, curiosity, trustworthiness, and being outgoing, make an outstanding student like Hannah Hill. Hannah is an example of these skills and attributes being put to use. Skills that Hannah obtains include being assertive, being a problem solver, engaging her creativity, and being a collaborator. And attributes that Hannah has that make her an outstanding student at iTech include being involved, being motivated, being a leader, and being outgoing. I would like to end with a quote from Jonathan Gerlach. We need to stop developing learners and start developing thinkers. Learners rely on directions, while thinkers problem solve and develop solutions. Hannah, along with many other students at iTech, have become thinkers instead of learners because of the way we are taught. Thank you and see you next month.
Thank you, Janessa.
Dr. Webb, members of the board, and some media guests, I'm Alexa Atterbury from the Vancouver Flex Academy. This month, I was asked about what makes an outstanding teacher. So what does make an outstanding teacher? To me, an outstanding teacher is someone who is passionate about their job, takes interest in the success of their students, and someone who strives to make a safe and comfortable learning environment. One teacher who does this is Mr. Plouse. Mr. Plouse is our only history teacher at Flex and is an English teacher as well. He is an outstanding teacher because he always pushes his students to do their best and work hard. Another teacher who is outstanding at Flex is Ms. Gunderson. Ms. Gunderson is one of our English teachers, and she always wants what is best for her students and makes everyone feel welcome in her classes. And last but not least, Mr. Lin Lu. Even though he's our principal, he was also a teacher once. This is his first year at Flex, and he is already making changes for the better. He is one of the most outgoing and passionate principals I have ever met, and he checks in with every student about their grades once a week to touch base with them, which is very important in a small school. Thank you, and have a lovely Valentine's Day.
Thank you, Alexa.
Good evening, Dr. Webb, members of the board, and community guests. I'm Elizabeth Korn, representative for Fort Vancouver High School Center for International Studies, and I'm here this evening to talk to you about some of the amazing programs that are available to students at my school. I'll first begin talking about the National Honor Society and the importance it holds at my school. For some people, being a member of the National Honor Society simply means an additional tassel on graduation day. But in reality, this program offers so much more, including the ability for students to learn leadership qualities, academic skills, and develop personal characteristics which will serve them throughout their life. Through the Red Cross program, students also learn important life lessons as they come to understand the importance of helping others and the positive influence we can all have on our community. Our associate student body helps to instill students with responsibilities and teaches the importance of teamwork as it will relate to our lives as adults, both personally and professionally. Finally, our AVID program assists students in gaining relevant abilities in organization and goal setting. These lessons prepare our students for both college and hardworking worlds. These programs, along with many other offered at Fort Vancouver High School Center for International Studies, provide a solid foundation for students' growth and development. It is because of these programs that our students and are better people, students, and community leaders. Thank you and happy Valentine's Day.
Great animations, Elizabeth. You can give some of us a little lesson on those after the meeting.
Good afternoon, Dr. Webb, members of the board, and community guests. My name is Julia Hayes, and I am representing Columbia River High School. This month, I was asked to highlight one of the students at my school who I think is exceptional for their accomplishments and achievements. Therefore, I decided to talk about my good friend, Rachel Farina. So, who is Rachel Farina? I can honestly say that she's one of the kindest, sweetest people I know. These are a few pictures that I took just from hanging out with her. I also think that she's a really good role model. She's very involved. She's been in Science Olympiad ever since middle school, totaling 6 years now. She's very smart, great at science. She's taking both physics and biology right now. She's also very involved with Red Cross. She's the activities coordinator and treasurer for the Southwest Washington Youth Council. Just this weekend, she helped put on a leadership conference where students learned CPR and other leadership qualities. She's also the ASB secretary. In this picture, you can see she's making a poster. And as secretary, she's very dedicated to getting her work done on time and done well. She's also been involved in soccer for as long as I've known her. So I chose to talk about Rachel because, like I said, she's one of the kindest, sweetest people I know. And she's very smart and hardworking, making her a great example of a River student. She maintains a very high GPA despite the amount of work she has to do. One quote I got from her this morning was just her saying she wished she had less homework so she could do more of the stuff that she enjoys. I hope you all have a great Valentine's Day, and I will see you next month. Thank you.
Thanks, Julie. Good evening, Dr. Webb, members of the board, and community guests. My name is Grace Eversall, and I'm from Skyview High School. I will be talking to you today about how sports, clubs, cultural experiences, and other activities educate the whole person at Skyview. In sports, there are many lessons learned, one being to work hard. In playing on the varsity soccer team for 4 years, I learned that you have to work hard to get a starting spot on the field. However, it also showed me that you have to work hard to achieve your goals. In sports at Skyview, you learn teamwork and how to work with others and encouraging others. As you can see in this image of gymnastics, a gymnast named Allison is being supported by her fellow teammates, bringing a smile to her face. Lastly, one learns to be inclusive in sports through the promotion of it from our coaches. Lessons Skyview students learn in clubs that helps educate them is the importance of reaching out to the community. For example, NHS includes many hours of community service where students learn to build relationships and do things for others without a reward. Also, responsibility is learned. For example, in drama club, you have to make sure you always bring your script and are keeping up with remembering and rehearsing your lines or your dances, even if that means doing it at home. Leadership is acquired from not only ASB, but in P Club, where leadership skills are acquired through service. Lastly, other clubs, such as AVID, educate a student on good study habits, organization, and even basic but helpful skills, such as taking notes. One of our cultural clubs at Skyview is called Mecha, and it has a mission statement to promote higher education for Latino students. They do community service and organize events such as the Baile Familiar, which includes lots of dancing, food, and fun. If you are in this club, then you learn that anyone can achieve anything. Embrace your culture and help others. Overall, the main lessons learned by all clubs, sports, and other activities is to be inclusive, work hard, and encourage others. One last event put on by Skyview High School is Student Chest Drive. Student Chest Drive teaches students that some people have life much harder and a little bit of money can go a long way. The fundraisers show students that giving to others is much more powerful than buying something for yourself that isn't needed. Thank you, and I wish you all a great evening.
Thank you for sharing those thoughtful lessons with us tonight, Grace.
Okay, Dr. Webb, members of the board, and special guests, my name is Trisha Beavers, and I'm here from Hudson's Bay High School. Today, I'd also like to talk about what makes an outstanding student. I'd like to introduce Sophia Tarki. She's an international student at Hudson's Bay. She comes from Italy, and she's spending the year with us as a senior. She kind of amazes me. She's in AP courses. She's a member of Key Club, the National Honor Society. She's done a sport every season. And I asked her what it meant to be outstanding and what, you know, advice she would give to outstanding students, and she says that the keys to scholastic success are persistence, dedication, and efficient time management, which I thought was really inspiring, so I have to share with us. Another outstanding student at Hudson's Bay is Ethan Myers. Ethan is ASB president. He's he's like the captain of every team, cross country, swimming. He's hardworking and honor roll student, that's what I was trying to say. When I asked Ethan advice for other students who'd like to be outstanding in the way that I see him, he says that hard work pays off when times become difficult. Don't stop after reaching a goal, create another one to keep reaching higher. When looking at students who excel at school, I've gathered that they all contain the same three traits: responsibility, integrity, and the ability to ask questions. These students believe that education is a privilege and they choose to take complete advantages of their opportunities. This is what makes them outstanding. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Trisha.
Dr. Webb, members of the board, and community guests, my name is Celeste Bernstein and I'm from the Vancouver School of Arts and Academics. Tonight I'm here to talk to you about how technology is supporting education at VSAA. So first I'd like to talk a little bit about the iPads and kind of their basic use in a classroom setting. So the first thing I'd like to talk about is online testing. A majority of the tests we take now in class, most of our exams are actually taken on the iPads through an app called Canvas. This allows direct feedback, minimal grading errors, and sometimes even multiple attempts. In my physics class, we have two attempts, and if you can complete both attempts in the time allotted, you actually get to take the higher score on your test. The next aspect of the iPads that supports education is AirPlay/presentations. So AirPlay allows you to directly stream what's on your iPad up on the screen, similar to what I'm doing right now, except it's a Bluetooth function. And essentially, students are able to present off their iPad right away. You can use apps like GoodNotes to kind of do live tutorials for other students, present projects, different things like that. And finally is videos. Teachers can actually create tutorials with their iPads and upload them to their websites or their Canvas sites, so students have access to that who need additional help outside of class. Next, our CTE classes are also benefiting from technology. The pictures are some students who are doing some video editing as well as audio editing, and an entire art form at VSAA, moving image arts, is completely reliant on technology. They're using the cameras, they're using the editing softwares, and here they are. Next is, what are people at VSAA saying about technology? On the far left, this is the health teacher. He said, when you just speak the words, some people don't understand or hear. So I like to use technology for warm-ups with a question of the day, due dates on the screen, and essentially he's just saying that he's using technology as a different means of communication. My physics teacher says that technology reduces the use of paper and is more efficient. The response time for assessments and turned-in work is immediate. And finally, a student says that it can decrease the amount of books you have, turn things in digitally, and you can work on a group project on a shared document even when you're not together. Finally, how could technology make things even better? Ultimately, I think that the most effective use is when you actually know how to use your technology, the shortcuts, learning research strategies, and finally having a balance between technology and hands-on learning so we're accommodating for all kinds of students. Thank you.
Thank you, Celeste, and thank you to all the students for sharing part of your Valentine's Day with us this evening. Awesome. You're welcome to go or stay.
I have to say, you're so confident and you're awesome. Thank you.
Nicely done, ladies. Happy Valentine's Day.
You too.
Share the love.
Do we have any written correspondence that the board has not yet seen?
No.
Dr. Webb?
That's all right.
And next on our agenda, we have the approval of minutes from November 8th, 2016, November 22nd, 2016, and December 13th, 2016. Do I have a motion?
That we approve the minutes. Thank you.
Second.
Any questions or discussion? No? Those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Passes unanimously. Next, we have the consent agenda for instructional administrative support services. Okay, I have a motion to approve the consent agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Any questions or discussion?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Passes unanimously as well. And next we have our first item of regular business, administrative support services, a recommendation to conduct a first reading to adopt new policy 6170.
Yes, the Every Student Succeeds Act under Title I Part A provides new protections for students in foster care. ESSA deleted students awaiting foster placement from the definition of homeless youth in the McKinney-Vento Act. The revised ESSA provisions for students in foster care are designed to mitigate barriers caused by mobility both in and out of the foster care system. ESSA establishes protections for students in foster care that are the same or similar to those provided to homeless students. I'd ask that we waive the reading, and unless you've got questions or comments, we'll bring this back for board consideration on February 28th.
I was just going to say, I think that Mark and I discovered in the policy meeting that in the past we haven't been able to identify our foster students. So I think our ability to identify them and then deliver appropriate services is a really important and good thing. So I'm glad we're heading down that path.
Mitigating out of school time because of transitions is critically important.
And school becomes their stability. You know, it's a place where they go, where they can be cared about.
Okay, second, the next item of regular business is a recommendation to approve the request for state waiver of 4 emergency closure days.
Washington state law requires a 180-day school year with limited exceptions. Vancouver Public Schools is eligible for a waiver of 4 missed school days based on the state of emergency declared by Governor Inslee in response to the winter storm that commenced on January 10, 2017. This historically rare and significant storm necessitated, for safety reasons, the closure of Vancouver Public Schools on January 11th, 12th, 13th, and 17th. Winter weather events in December caused Vancouver Public Schools to use all 4 emergency closure makeup dates built into the board adopted in employee bargain 2016-17 calendar, which were June 19th, 20th, and 21st, and January 30th in priority order. The January storm extended the calendar to include June 22nd, 23rd, 26th, and 27th, potentially imposing hardships on families who plan and purchase summer vacation travel, high school students who depend on summer employment, and employees who enroll in continuing education programs. In submitting this request, Vancouver Public Schools must certify to the Office of the Superintendent of Public Instruction that it can meet the other statutory requirement for an annual average of 1,027 instructional hours, and that its board of directors supports a waiver of 4 missed school days. Let the record show that we are 4 days of instructional time above the 1,027, with the assumption that the 4 waiver days are approved by OSPI. Our average instructional hours would be 1,051. Most of the districts in the region who are adding minutes are doing so because they're not at the 1,027. So I just want to be clear, we are 4 days above the minimum instructional hour requirement. It's a recommendation that the Board of Directors approves a request for OSPI to waive 4 school days missed during the 2016-17 academic year due to the recent winter storm which led to Governor Inslee's declaration of state of emergency.
Is there a motion on the table?
Yeah. So move that we approve the application for a waiver in state.
Second. Any questions or comments?
I had a comment and a question. I understand that we receive feedback from our constituents and our community, and they're very much in favor. And I just would say, as a school board director, of course we're concerned when we apply for waivers, but to know that we remain in excess of the required instructional hours is a point of pride for VPS. But my question is there any discussion or thought that, you know, is anyone thinking going forward we're going to see more of this kind of weather and we're building in more days, or we're going to stick with kind of, you know, where we're going to look at trends and just kind of, I mean, we're not going to...
For this year or for,
next year.
For the next
yeah,
calendar?
Yeah, when we look forward, are yeah. we concerned that we're going to see more
yeah,
of this?
Yeah, the board acted on the...
in the consent.
In the consent, yes, with 4 days.
4 days.
The historical use of snow days has never exceeded more than 3 days until this winter, which is why we built in 4 days.
So it would be next year when we, if we had another bad year, where we might add like a fifth day.
We could certainly
just
consider
that.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. But we all hope that won't occur.
This is really unprecedented, though, because. All the time I was teaching, we never ever went over 3 days. And this was like, what? We're out of school for how many days? 8. Of course, it could be worse, like Stevenson out 14. So we're just, you know, blessed that we can. I mean, there's no guarantee that OSPI will even say yes, but I think it's important that we respect our constituency, their needs. We're the school for the 27th of June.
Any other questions? And so we can vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any opposed unanimously. Dr. Webb, is there a superintendent's report this evening?
No superintendent's report.
Can I ask a clarifying question on the agenda?
Please do.
When we passed consent, you mentioned instructional administrative support services. We also had fiscal support services, so I just want to clarify that we pass the consent on both items. We'll take additional vote.
Well,
I did note that. Typically, Madam Chair, we just say the consent so we don't take each one of those subsections. So for the record, if we could just go back and entertain a motion for the other subsection and a second.
Perfect.
So moved.
Thanks for bringing that to attention,
so
Mark.
What? Let's be specific.
For the consent agenda, fiscal support service.
Okay, great. Thank you. Is there a second to that?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
You definitely want to pay the bills.
Thank you, Mark, for pointing that out. And Rosemary, you have a legislative report you want to share this evening?
Yes. Spent the day on the Hill yesterday and all day Sunday we were in meetings to get prepared for the day on the Hill. I will say that we can be cautiously optimistic that we should see some compromise in Olympia because they don't have a choice, really, because they are, the court has said you will do this. However, we did try to explain to several of the legislators that it's important that they act before April 30th because for some reason they think that that's okay. And we said, no, it's not, because school districts don't operate on a legislative timeline. We actually have to prepare things, like if we don't get certain, like the levy cliff, for instance, we have to tell teachers by May 15th, and it takes us a little longer. It's not like you just do this one day in advance. So we did make sure that they did understand that we have to prepare, which takes time and effort, two parallel, you know, two budgets. So trying to explain that to them, I think, was an important point. Very receptive to the financial impacts of what is happening to schools if the legislator doesn't act in a timely and in a, we emphasize they cannot do harm, whatever they're, you know, they've got to come to a compromise that will do no harm to other segments of the state budget that would hurt families, because we are concerned about our students and their families. And so we try to explain that also, that that's very important if they're considering how they're going to make the public funding their paramount duty. I would say that it was a good day. Talked to lots of senators and House reps. They're good people that have created a huge situation that's not easy. It's very complex, of course. And so they're trying to work with the governor, they're trying to work with each other, and so so I would say we can be cautiously optimistic for a good outcome. Hopefully they'll be done on time, I don't know, but they are working to try to resolve the issue.
So I was wondering, Dr. Webb, are we, it may be a waste of time, and it's fine if you say that, we modeled the governor's budget, and will we model the two opposing plans, or plans that the Senate Republicans came up with and the House Democrats came up with?
Let me ask Brad. It's a bit more complex.
Oh, yeah.
To do that, and there are so many variables that there are some assumptions that we have to bring to that. We understand that the Senate Democrats released their budget today. The rumor has it that the House Republicans will release their budget on Tuesday, as early as next Tuesday. But Brett, maybe we've done the strengths and weaknesses in both of the bills and have shipped off our feedback to our Southwest Washington legislative delegation, to Senate Ways and Means and House Appropriations, and to both education committees in both chambers, and then of course to caucus leadership in both chambers as well.
Well, I'm wondering if there's value at this point, and I truly believe there is, in educating the public about what we're up against, given that it's the final year of implementation, given the fact that we finally have some proposals. Some are horrific and not to be taken seriously, and to where they'll end up. But I think that if the district were to take the lead in informing our citizens, then they could become powerful advocates to get a solution that we truly need, because at this point there's still a lot of I think purposeful misinformation that voters are hearing, and it's our job to inform.
Sure.
To simply inform.
Yeah, sure.
But I know it takes a lot of time.
Brett, talk a little bit about some of the complexities and whether or not to what extent we might be able to model both the Senate and House plans that have been released today.
So I guess as we talk about the Senate plan, the Senate Republicans plan, now that we have a Senate Democrat plan, we'll differentiate the two. That obviously is a pretty massive sea change in terms of how the dollars are delivered to districts and then the corresponding reaction on the expenditure side by the districts. The revenue side isn't quite as hard now that we kind of have the nooks and crannies identified a little bit more. At first, we would have dramatically misrepresented the revenue looking at the bullet points without digesting all of the caveats and specialized language that they had built into that. What I still would struggle with is we would have to make some broad assumptions on the expenditure side, because it's one thing to tell on the revenue side, but where there's corresponding impact on the expenditure side, that's the only way to fairly represent. So we can look at trying to do that, but I guess I would be a little hesitant because there would be so much speculation.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, on the one that you just talked about, we're talking about improvements in the hundreds of millions of dollars in the best case scenario, but the other proposal actually is talking about the billions that's required. So, I don't know. I mean, it's up to you all, but I just think that in terms of activating the people who can advocate for change very effectively.
Sure. Well, let us think about this and see how we might be able to elevate some of what we've already elevated, but do it more in a sort of public work session or in a report to the board, so that becomes part of the public conversation.
Right. We've had pieces before, I know, on our website where we do a really great job of keeping people up to date on, it's a very consequential year. So just keeping people aware of this is what's happening. I mean, the reality is we're the only reliable news source in this region for that information. It's the only place people can go is our website. to understand exactly what's being proposed and exactly the impact. No one else is covering it.
One thing I have to say that came out of the conversations is that the intellectual honesty of the numbers is in question. And so this is posing some dilemma for some of the House and some of the senators. They don't know what numbers can the numbers be trusted that they're giving? And so this is causing some hang up with trying to talk through the bill, either proposal, the House bill, or the Senate. So that was a concern about where you're coming up with these numbers. You know, are the numbers really applicable on the broad scale? I mean, can you really say that that's going to happen? You're saying $12,500 per student. Can that really happen?
Yeah, that's why it's even more, it's more right. essential than ever in any year that I've seen, just in the time that I've been on the board, is we have a fantasy land that's being presented, and then we have two other, I mean, this is just my perspective. And it's really important that we put out the facts and don't wait for anyone else to do it for us, because I just believe that given the facts, our people will know what to do.
They did encourage us there. One of the comments was made is that they're not seeing, like, not enough people are contacting right. legislators. Not enough people will be willing to go up and testify. So that is something that we're going to try to do better, the school board directors, by setting up some other things, but that they really need people to say something, because if people don't, we may end up with what we don't want. And so that was just, those are two concerns that were raised yesterday.
Yeah, we have people who should know better saying that there have been $4 billion of new revenue put into schools in the last two biennia, and it's absolutely not true. It's $2 billion at best. And, just something else to worry about. Happy Valentine's Day.
I think your point is well taken. Let's let the team noodle a bit and bring something to you on the 28th.
Yeah, thanks for the discussion.
Yeah.
Any other reports or information to share? I would like to recognize the district and the FCRC team who were awarded, recognize and congratulate, who were awarded a National Magna Award from the National School Directors Association, which is a really big deal. We all know this work has been really important, it's been a really big deal, and it's really exciting to see the word get out across the country and that recognition be out there on a broader basis. So thanks for the work that you do, Kim and Tamara and team and everybody who's involved, and thanks for making us proud.
Yeah, and I remember this discussion in a goal area team meeting that we had for our design too. And so it was great to see it come to fruition. And before we close, I do want to give my prediction for the bond tonight.
Over or under?
75%. You heard it here first. We'll be in excess, but I'm lowballing it. Because I don't want to appear too optimistic. But. On that note, our Citizens Committee for Good Schools has done a fabulous job. Every document that's produced, everything that they did has been exceptional, I think. And it'll be a great night.
I had constituents tell me that the information, and this is kudos to the whole team, communication, that the communication on this bond was done very well. I mean, people understood it. They had great information, and I said, I know, and I'm so proud to be part of the group. So it was really, really great. And so, you should know that the public appreciated the great information out there. And so I predict, too, that we're going to be able to. Yay.
We'll end on a high note. Thank you, everybody. Our meeting is adjourned.